This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Grace to you and peace in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship at the First Presbyterian Church of Warminster, and a special welcome to those who worship with us through WRDV FM radio. Today's liturgist is Carol, and our musical gifts are offered by Kathy Worth Bulkus on organ and piano, and our senior choir, conducted by our director of music, Dave Sathra. God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Worship begins with the sounding of the chimes. Before turning to scripture, let us pray. Gracious God, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in the ways of eternal life, through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen.
1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 through 20. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel!" And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli, and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, Samuel. Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, Here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call, my son. Lie down again. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, Here I am, for you called me. Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, Speak, for your servant is listening. Then the Lord said to Samuel, See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever. Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son. He said, Here I am. Eli said, What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also, if you hide anything from me of all that he told you. So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him. As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. And from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 5 through 12. For we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, Let light shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our bodies. For while we live, we are always being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be made visible in our mortal flesh. So, death is at work in us, but life in you.
Our gospel lesson is from the second chapter of Mark, verses 23 through chapter 3, verse 6. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need of food? He entered the house of God when Abiathar was the high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which it is not lawful for any but the priests to eat. And he gave some to his companions." Then he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for humankind, and not humankind for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." Again, he entered the synagogue, and a man was there who had a withered hand. They watched him to see whether he would cure him on the Sabbath so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man who had the withered hand, "Come forward." Then he said to them, "Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save life or to kill?" But they were silent. He looked around at them with anger. He was grieved at their hardness of heart and said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out and immediately conspired with the Herodians against him, how to destroy him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
Thanks
be
be
to
to God.
God.
Amen. Well, if you're like me, you've often heard or even said that the phrase that the children in our congregations are, quote, the future of the church. And while that may be true in the temporal sense, it doesn't come close to the spiritual significance of the presence of children in the family of faith, because they are far more important to just the future of the church. They are an essential part of the church in the present, here and now. Yes, we hope they will grow up to become leaders in the church one day, but today, now, God is shaping and forming them into the image of Christ. Now, of course, children need adults to help them grow in faith, but we also need them to remind us that the Spirit never stops shaping and forming us. We must all be like children if we are to keep growing in faith. Now, our congregation has long been blessed by the vocation to guide children through their faith journeys and to help them hear God's voice. We have a children and youth ministry coordinator, a children's choir director, and Sunday school teachers who show up whether they have 10 students in class that morning or just one. But it doesn't stop with these adult leaders, because all of us have a role to play in nurturing children. Your prayers, your generosity, and most importantly, your discipleship shows all of our children what it looks like to love God, who then sends us out into the world to love our neighbors. In today's Old Testament lesson, we see that the young boy Samuel has an adult in his life named Eli, who helps him discern that it is not he who is calling him in the middle of the night and waking him from sleep. It's the voice of God. So without Eli there to help him, we might wonder if Samuel would ever have come to recognize who was calling him by name, because we are told he is young and has no knowledge of the Lord. It takes an adult to teach him whose voice he is hearing and how to respond. The Lord provides Eli to help Samuel make the shift from passively hearing God's word to actively listening to it. So, if we need a biblical example of what we are called to do for all children, we have Eli. All of us at some point have had Elis in our lives, and the more the better. So, who were the Elis during your childhood? Who set the example for you to follow Jesus? Who taught you to read scripture and to pray and to sing? Perhaps it was a Sunday school teacher, a family member, a minister, or a friend, maybe even someone younger than you was your Eli. And if you weren't a churchgoer as a child, it might have been someone in your neighborhood or school. Whatever the case, God wants us to help each other hear his voice. And we need to provide frameworks and opportunities to help children grow from hearing to listening to following. Now, for most of us, that framework was weekly Sunday school. But that model is not as old as we might think. For centuries, the spiritual formation of children was the responsibility of parents in the home and pastors in the church. Sunday school, as we know it, has its roots in the Sabbath school movement, which emerged soon after the beginning of the Industrial Revolution in the mid-1700s. In those days, many children in urban areas were made to work in factories 6 days a week along with their parents, which left little time for religious instruction at home. So men and women in both England and in America began organizing educational programs for them on Sundays because it was the only day of the week they had off. Later in the 1800s, it became more formalized and structured, with education wings added to church buildings, Christian camps held during the summer, and Sunday school superintendents appointed to oversee and expand programming for children and youth. And if you want to know what that might have looked like, one of the pioneers of the Sabbath school movement was Englishman Robert Raikes, and he wrote this to describe what a typical schedule on Sundays was like for children. He wrote, "The children were to come after 10 in the morning and stay till 12. They were then to go home and return at 1. And after reading a lesson, they were to be conducted to church. After church, they were to be employed in repeating the catechism till after 5, and then dismissed with an injunction to go home without making a noise." Obviously, times have changed since then, and they're still changing now. But the same principle, the same value is at work, which is that the Spirit of God blows where it will, and the church must adapt to changing circumstances in order to keep the faith formation of children a priority. Now, obviously, children and youth today don't work in factories 6 days a week, but their lives are pretty busy, much more than when we were children. So our churches need to find new ways to nurture them, not just on Sunday mornings, but whenever and wherever there is opportunity throughout the week, during the summer, at home, at church, and out in the community. Because whether they are in church or elsewhere, the Lord will never stop calling them to serve him and their neighbors. We must find ways to open their ears to the voice of the Lord. And that takes humility, imagination, creativity, and above all, love. Perhaps our most important responsibility is to make sure that our children don't see us serving them, but that they see the power of God at work within us. Because the Apostle Paul reminds us that we are not proclaiming ourselves, we are not proclaiming the church as it is, we are proclaiming Jesus Christ. As we raise all our children in the faith, we must remember that we are but jars of clay. We are not perfect. And when our children grow up and learn the full story of Samuel and Eli, they'll learn that Eli is far from perfect. But the Lord still uses him to raise a new leader named Samuel. Who are our Samuels? How do we open their ears? How do we teach our children that, yes, the church belongs to Jesus and that he will always take care of it? But the church, too, is an earthen vessel. And yet, the Lord brought us together to be the church. And to entrust us with the treasure of the gospel. And our ultimate goal is for that and only that to shine through our lives to the children in our midst. Friends, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Amen.
Through man.
Now let us turn our hearts to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, you have sent your Holy Spirit to help us to pray. So receive these prayers of hope and healing on behalf of the church and the world. Lord, give your wisdom to all leaders to resist the earthly powers of fear and violence that destroy our common life. In the face of injustice, oppression, and brutal power, strengthen our wavering wills to stand in the power of Jesus. Stir within us the power to care for your creation, not as resources to be exploited, but as a precious gift to be held in trust as a revelation of your faithfulness. Lord, inspire your church to share Christ's love beyond the safety of its walls and fill us with an infectious joy for sharing your gospel as we wait for and welcome your coming kingdom. Bring healing and wholeness to all who are suffering in mind, body, or spirit. Bring peace and protection to those burdened by terror and trauma of any kind, especially the people of Ukraine, Haiti, the Sudan, and Palestine and Israel. Merciful God, in Christ you make all things new. Transform the poverty of our nature by the riches of your grace. And in the renewal of our lives, make known your heavenly glory, shining through the face of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord and to love and serve our neighbors. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever.
Amen.